This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So typically, well, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive, and I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it, and when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper Talk this is.
All right, so let's go ahead and get started for the next talk here. So this is pretty exciting as HamSCI is a new development within amateur radio, and it's got a lot of attention and doing citizen science using amateur radio. So I'd like to introduce to you Nathan or Nathaniel?
Nathaniel.
I don't know why.
But I go by Nate on the air.
Okay, he goes by Nate on the air because it's only four letters. Frisnell, W2NAF. Now, he's also a professor, so he's got a team of people here, and the work that they've done with the solar eclipse that just recently went through the United States. So we're excited. Let's give a round of applause for Nathan and his group.
Thank you very much, Steve. I really appreciate that, and I appreciate being here. So a little bit more about myself. I'm now an assistant research professor at NJIT, but I study the ionosphere and the magnetosphere, but the reason I'm doing this is actually because I became a ham radio operator back when I was in high school, around that age. I actually learned about ham radio back in middle school on a scouting trip. So Jamboree on the Air, when I was in eighth grade, that's what set the spark. So, and I've just followed it through, and eventually I ended up getting my PhD in ionospheric physics, and now I'm here. So I'm really a ham radio operator first, and then that led me to this career in space physics. So while I was a graduate student at Virginia Tech working on my PhD, I ended up going on a trip to help build a Super Dawn radar at Adak Island, which is in between mainland Alaska and Russia. And I was on that island with Ethan Miller, K8GU. He's a scientist at the Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory. And he told me about the reverse beacon network. And we all had our rigs and we were doing some CW and kind of a mini-D expedition, but that was the first time I learned about the RBN. And as a graduate student, I spent a tremendous amount of time looking at ionospheric data from radars and stuff, and I said, I bet we can learn something about the ionosphere from the reverse beacon network and looking at this data. And that's kind of where this whole idea got started. And so today, I'm also I'm here with a team of people. So Bill Engelke, he may or may not be able to speak right now, but also we have my students from NJIT, Josh Katz, KD2JAO, Spencer Gunning, K2AEM, and Josh Vega. They're all standing over there, and they will be presenting during this presentation as well. So this presentation is going to start off with what is HamSCI? And then we're going to have Josh and Bill talk about the HamSCI database. And then Spencer K2AEM and Josh WB2JSV and myself will be talking about the Eclipse experiments, and then we'll summarize and bring some closure to it. So what is HamSCI? I started talking a little bit about where it came from. HamSCI is a ham radio science citizen investigation. And I mentioned that I said, oh, we can use this RBN data to actually look at what's happening in the ionosphere. And later that led to the idea that we could actually create an organization that connects the professional ionospheric physics community with the amateur radio operators. And in a lot of ways, the ham radio operators use the ionosphere all the time and use space weather, but may not have a really deep understanding of the physics behind all of it. And the physicists, they may know a lot about how the ionosphere and space weather works, but maybe they don't know the practical applications of it. For instance, some physicists I know that have been working in the field for many, many years before he became a ham radio operator, he didn't know that you were able to communicate hundreds or thousands of miles using just a couple of watts of power on the HF bands. And so that was really interesting. So we have a real opportunity here to create an organization that both the ham radio operators and the scientists and the people who live in both worlds can learn something from each other. So HamSCI has three major objectives. One, we want to advance scientific research and understanding through amateur radio activities. And two, we want to encourage the development of new technologies to support this research. And three, we want to provide educational opportunities for the amateur community and the general public. So we are both trying to create ham radio activities, we're trying to generate research, so we're a citizen science organization and an outreach organization, and we're trying to really bring these two communities together. So who's part of HamSCI? Our organizational structure is rather loose right now. It's a bit organic. I'm the coordinator or the leader, and I'm at the New Jersey Institute of Technology. And we now have a listserv with people from all of these different organizations. And so people from all of these organizations have contributed in some way to the things that HamSCI does today. And many of us go to major science meetings. So these are HamSCI members at the 2016 American Geophysical Union meeting in San Francisco. And we actually were presenting things related to ham radio using ham radio in our data. So with that, it looks like Bill is here. So I'm now going to turn it over to Bill Engelke. Without further ado.
Now that I have your attention. Well, thanks, Nate. It's a great honor to be here. This seems like the creme de la creme of the ham radio community here. I feel like the seventh husband of Zsa Zsa Gabor. I know what it is I have to do. I just hope that I can make it interesting. I'm not going to go through all of this in complete detail because you can read it. Because we have so much to cover, I'm going to try and be brief. My part of this started out as just a laziness thing. I wanted to be able to see what bands were open. So I started a data collection system which would collect data off the DX cluster and then save it in a database and show it to me using various analytics tools. Analytics and data analysis are a part of the growing world of data science. Data analysis is to understand the data, and analytics is to use it for decision making. And the idea is to use it to forecast. A lot of times you'll hear a lot of talk about junk data. What we are moving into is a world of what we call big data, data that is not easily processed using conventional data processing techniques. Generally, we don't pay a whole lot of attention to junk data because it tends to average out like noise, where the signal tends to come out. So generally the impact from noise is negligible in most analytics. This is the system that I built. Let's see, because the other speakers had so much trouble with this pointer, I'm going to use my own here. I built a server which runs a Windows service. The Windows service talks, I have several of these running, looking at different DX clusters. So if one of them has a spot the other doesn't have, or if one of them is down, I still get the data, and I take out dupes, because if I see the same two stations on the same frequency in the same minute, well, it's got to be a dupe. And so this data I look up whenever I have a chance to find a call in QRZ.com, get the lat long information, grid information, if it's there. If it's not there, it's possible to estimate their location based on call, which is, of course, completely without value if it's a geographically large DX entity. We know how that is. You know, you have to do the best you can. It's a first effort. And then I put it into a server with an SQL database. Now, this is publicly available. The analytics package that looks at this is at this website, dxdisplay.caps.ua.edu. I'm part of the Center for Advanced Public Safety, which is mostly related to law enforcement. We're also moving now into disaster preparedness, which is where emergency communications and communications technology comes in. This should be, I'm pretty sure this is in your proceedings of the conference if you need that. Now, I published a paper on this in the QRZ.com news area, and pretty soon was contacted by the people from HamSCI because they recognized that we could combine data from the DX display database with some other databases that are available, such as the Reverse Beacon Network, WhisperNet, and perhaps some other ones as well. Jonathan will talk a little bit, Josh will talk in a minute about the detail of the of this database, which he designed. I'm using it for the most part. I didn't use it exactly, but it's pretty close. This is one of the simple displays you get out of this thing. You can adjust your time frame. I've got data for the last 5 years, so you can... what it defaults to is showing you the most recent 2 hours, and it defaults to, well, it's not shown here. It shows all these bands. There are other bands, of course, but again, this is what most people use, and you can filter by herd in US or anywhere in the world or by any DXCC entity. So that's one thing you can get. Another thing that we've done that's very interesting is to do analysis of volumes of QSOs reported, or that is spots, over a long period of time. This is about the past 5 years, where we plot the solar flux monthly averages against 6 meter spots. We looked at this with various different bands. With 6 meter spots, we can see there's very little impact to 6 meters from the sunspot cycle. So as we've gone from 2012 up to the most recent, 6 meters comes and goes just like it does. It seems to be largely seasonal. Now there's a lot of other analysis and analytics that we're going to get into, some of which are in the published things. I don't really have time to go into them in this presentation, but if you go to this website I just told you, a lot of the analysis is published there under the documentation and information areas. In case you're interested in that software I mentioned yesterday that allows you to monitor for DX stations and D-star stations, you can download the software from that website as well. There's also a plan afoot to add some of the other recent modes, such as DRM and fusion into that monitor. I'm going to turn it over to Josh at this point. He's going to go into some of the analysis he's done using some of this data. So thanks very much. Josh?
Hello, everybody. So I was hired by Dr. Frissell at NGIT to do some analysis of the RBN data. I'm a ham. I got my ticket in high school, and I started training for that my senior year, and then, you know, life in school gets the better of you, and then couldn't practice for a while. So then I ran in with Nathaniel at the radio club at New Jersey, K2MFF, and I started getting involved with his research, and that gave me more time to do my hobby. So I'm looking at ways we can use the amateur radio data to make sense of ionospheric propagation. So this is a density plot. So it's basically a heat map of the signal-to-noise ratio on the bottom and of the distance or path length between transmitters and receivers in the database that Bill and I worked together to create. As you can see, there's a bunch of clusters of transmitter and receiver locations at different SNRs. And these are basically the rate touchdown points, where when you're transmitting, where you're going to hit down at different points in the day and night cycle and at different propagation characteristics. So I've broken this up into day and night, and this is a plot of 7 megahertz communication, all of the data from the RBN. And as you can see, we can see distinct propagation characteristics of day and night. And we also, I have a lot of these plots broken up into like every day for the past 6 years. So I don't want to bore you with that. But the summary is we can tell differences between day and night and different solar flare conditions and stuff like that. And the next work is I've used a machine learning algorithm to pull out the locations of these hops. And this is just a plot of a single day. And you can see your average path distance for the first hop where you're hitting the ground and you're able to be heard drops during the night. So after a certain amount of time or during the day. And then you can only talk into a localized region on 40 meters in the morning. So it confirms what we'd expect. And we're going to continue doing this kind of analysis and try and pull out different metrics from our data. So I'm going to pass it over to Nathaniel again so we can talk about our efforts.
Thank you very much, Josh. So how many people here got to see the eclipse this past August? Raise your hand. Oh, a lot. How many people here got to see totality? Quite a few. This is excellent. And how many people were involved in some sort of radio activity during the eclipse? This is a great crowd. I'm not sure that I'll ever see this many hands go up again for my questions. So this is wonderful. So most of you are probably familiar with this map that just a few weeks ago, less than a month ago, there was a total solar eclipse where totality started in Oregon at 1716 UT, and within 90 minutes that went across the United States diagonally southeastward and ended in South Carolina at 1851 UT. And what this basically did was the shadow of the moon hit our upper atmosphere, and we know that that should cause a decreased in ionization. And this is a great experiment for both space scientists and for amateur radio operators because it's one of the few times that we get something that we can predict that shadow. We can predict how the solar inputs are going to change over time. The only other time we get to do that really is with day and night, but this is very different. It moves at a different speed in a different direction. The size of the shadow is very different. And so this led to the idea to study what types of impacts does this eclipse have on the ionosphere. And many different organizations were interested in this, including the ham radio operators. So I started working with the team at Virginia Tech they were originally planning on doing this more from just the professional side, and then I saw what they were doing. I said, oh, I bet we can do something with the RBN and that sort of thing, and that is what led to HamSCI. And so some of the questions we have are, what are the temporal and spatial scales of eclipse-induced ionospheric effects? Can we observe things like traveling ionospheric disturbances in the ionosphere caused by the eclipse? And how does the eclipse affect HF propagation? And these are all things we can use amateur radio to help study. I should note that people have actually been studying the impact of eclipses on the ionosphere for well over 50 years, 50, 60 years. You can find research on this. But now it's very rare that you have an eclipse go over such a large populated area like the United States In the past, we haven't had all this instrumentation spread all over the place or even to be able to do large-scale imaging to see what's happening and then bring the data together so quickly with things like the internet. So all of these advances in technology make it very important that we take yet another look at what eclipses are doing. So for the ham radio side of things, we coordinated through HamSCI I would say three different experiments or projects. One is the Solar Eclipse QSO Party. How many people participated in that? We had a couple. I don't think this is as much of an operator crowd as much as it is a builder crowd. But for me, one of the things I was really interested was actually setting up, trying to get scientific information out of something that ham radio operators do anyway. There are many people who enjoy contesting and just making QSOs. And multiple times a year, you have these contests that are just generating thousands of spots in the RBN and on PSK Reporter. And I'm wondering, you know, can we get useful scientific information out of that? So if we can create a contest that these contesters can generate lots of data for, this is a great opportunity to help answer that question. Can we get scientific information out of these things that ham radio operators enjoy doing anyway? So this allows us to create a quasi-random data set, and we get data from the Reverse Beacon Network, PSK Reporter, WhisperNet, and Logs, and Josh will, WP2JSV, he'll show some results from that in a little bit. Also, I started talking with John, N8UR, right over there, and Steve Ryer, WA9VNJ. I don't think he's here. But we started talking to them about some other experiments. For Tapper, I know you're very interested in software-defined radios, so we now have ways that you can just record entire bands to disk, and then we can do data analysis on that later, and John will show that in the next talk. And Steve Ryer, he is part of the frequency measurement test community, so for people who don't know, the ARRL runs this competition twice a year where they put a signal out on the air from a station that has a very stable transmitter, and people have to figure out exactly what frequency they're transmitting at. They don't publish exactly what frequency. They say we're around here, and then people have to go measure it, and they have to figure out how to remove effects that the ionosphere is putting on that signal. Well, now we're reversing that situation. We say, okay, go listen to WWV and CHU, where you know that it's a 10 megahertz exact signal, and now we want you to give us those ionospheric effects in those measurements. So I'll show you some of those effects as well. Some of the other groups that were out making measurements during the eclipse, Sky and Telescope magazine, they put a call for people to listen to AM broadcast stations. They expect propagation of AM, amplitude of AM broadcast stations to increase, similar to you being able to hear more distant AM stations at night. There's a group called Eclipse Mob, which is looking at VLF measurements. So that was another citizen science project. And then there's a number of professional measurements, including the MIT Incoherent Scatter Radar System at Haystack. The Haystack Observatory, GPS total electron content measurements, Inosons, the Super Dual Role Network, and from the Virginia Tech Project, they were out fielding these Inosons. And you can see that here's one of their stations at the Shaw Air Force Base, where they used just a simple chirp waveform on a 5-watt EDIS USRP operating between 3 to 6 megahertz, and that generated 3 terabytes of data, and they'll be using that. One student there will be using that to get his PhD analyzing that data over the next few years. So that's very exciting. So from our perspective, the data collection, for the Solar Eclipse QSO Party, we've received over 571 logs. We've successfully parsed through 571 of them so far, and we have over 28,000 QSOs just in our submitted logs. Through Zenodo.org, this is a website run by CERN where people can submit data sets as large as 50 gigabytes at a time, and then they're permanently archived on CERN servers, and they're available for public consumption. So you can go here right now, and you can go to the HamSCI community, and you can look at any of the data that people have submitted, these wideband recording measurements and some of these frequency recording measurements. The reverse beacon network, we had over 625,000 spots. PSK reporter, we're still counting. I mean, poor Josh over there, he has to go through, and he has to count every single one by hand, and that takes a long time. And you can see he's already done a really good job over here. We're thinking of getting a few more abacuses in to help us speed up the processing. But for now, this is what we have. And then WhisperNet, we have over 640,000 spots there. So it's a lot of data to look at. Now, what happened on August 21st, the day of the eclipse, geomagnetically? This is one of the first things you want to look at as a space scientist. You want to say, okay, was it disturbed geomagnetically? Was there a solar flare? Was KP high? Things like that. This is a very complicated slide. There's a lot of information on it, but the main takeaway from it is that things were overall fairly geomagnetically quiet and fairly stable. Down on the bottom here, these little green dots are KP. In the white area, that's 14 UT to 22 UT on August 21st. That's when the Solar Eclipse QSO Party was happening. So KP was low the whole time, all quiet. Something called the Disturbance Storm Time Index that measures whether or not we're having a geomagnetic storm. That was also a very low value. The interplanetary magnetic field, the magnetic field from the sun, that was all at nominal values. It was mostly pointed northward, which means we get much less coupling from the sun. There were no spikes in the dynamic pressure of the solar wind, things like that. And this is good for this particular experiment, because that means when we look at the ham radio data, we can say that the effects we see are more likely to be due to the eclipse itself rather than something that the sun or the magnetosphere is doing. So this simplifies our analysis. We also looked at solar flares. So this is 12 UT on the left-hand side, and it goes to 0 UT of August 22nd on the right-hand side. We just had two small solar flares, C-class, nothing really big. So again, we had generally favorable conditions for that. So some of the best observations that have been sent to me so far came from Steve Ryer, W9VNJ, and he was located here near Milwaukee, and he was listening to WWV on 10 megahertz, and he was using a system that he had a highly stable frequency reference that he locked his receiver to, and he was able to measure very small changes in WWV's frequency with respect to time. And so this is not from the eclipse day, this is from the day before, August 20th, so this is your control day. And you can see in the morning when the ionosphere was building up as the sun comes up, we're seeing more positive shifts. So this is 10 megahertz right along that center line, and this is 0.3 hertz higher. So this is 0.3 hertz higher than 10 megahertz, and down here, this is 0.3 hertz lower than 10 megahertz. So you can see this positive Doppler shift in the morning, which as the ionosphere is building up, that implies that the path lengths are getting shorter, causing a positive Doppler shift. And then things flattened out as the ionosphere was stable during the day. Then there's this funny bump here. And then at night, you have these negative Doppler shifts as the ionosphere recombines and the sunlight goes away. So this is all what we expect, except for this bump. Anyone have an idea why this bump is here?
Is that critical hour?
I don't think this is critical hour. Do you remember this plot that I showed you here? Okay, so this is from August 21st, but these are solar flares, right? So when you get a solar flare, you get a sudden enhancement in the ionosphere. If you suddenly enhance the D region, that's what creates the radio blackouts, but it can suddenly enhance, you know, more than just the D region. So this spike, if we look at the GOES plot from that day, there's a solar flare that was observed at the same time as that spike in frequency. So that's nice, showing how these Doppler measurements or these frequency measurements are matching up with what we see. Now, let's look at what happened on the day of the eclipse. It's very nice. So this is the eclipse day. Do you think you see the eclipse in there? Yeah. So again, this is Steve's slide, and he very nicely marked off where the partial eclipse started, where the maximum eclipse happened, midway between his station and the WWV, and when partial eclipse ended. And just like on the control day, we see the positive Doppler shifts, and then when the partial eclipse starts coming, you expect the ionosphere to start recombining again, the path lengths to get a little bit longer, and there you see the negative Doppler shifts, and you see at maximum eclipse, you see this very interesting S curve, which we need to think about a little bit, and then you start seeing positive Doppler shifts as the ionosphere starts building up again after the eclipse.
Is your vertical scale the same on the control day and the scale?
Yes, it is. So this is 0.3 hertz higher than 10 megahertz, and this is 0.3 hertz lower than 10 megahertz.
Why is the spike here?
That's something we'll have to work on. I don't know that answer yet. That's
We've got sunspots on eclipse day.
Yeah.
That's possible. Yeah. So
there were four big ones. I saw them.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that could be one possibility. Yeah. So then things stabilized a bit, and then again you have the evening as it starts going down. So these are very, very nice measurements. And again, I should emphasize that we have a lot of data here, and this is all just like preliminary first look at this data. So we're not drawing any firm conclusions yet, but this is very nice, indicates that we see something. KD2 Bravo Delta, John Magliacane in New Jersey. He was doing things more along the Eclipse MOB side of things, so he made some 60 kilohertz observations of WWVB in Seagirt, New Jersey, and he also saw a nice eclipse effect. This is amplitude. He also has one where he measured the phase change, and you can see a nice phase change in those measurements as well. And then the guy who runs the Millstone Hill radar up in Massachusetts, he's also a ham, Whiskey One Papa Julia Echo, Phil Erickson. His father, 88-year-old John S. Erickson of Schenectady, New York, sat down with a AM shortwave receiver and just listened to 10 megahertz and 15 megahertz WWV. The 10 megahertz is in blue and the 15 megahertz is in orange. And he just wrote down what the S values, the S meter values were at different periods of time of WWV. And you can very clearly see the eclipse effects in here. And this is pretty much what we had expected. We thought that the lower frequencies would see some sort of enhancement because the D region was disappearing, so you get less D region absorption, while you'd see less good propagation on the higher bands because the maximum usable frequency would end up going down as the F layer started getting depleted. And that's what you see here very nicely.
The timing of eclipse local max is the path of the eclipse path or just local max?
I think in this one it's the where they had the most eclipse in Schenectady, New York. Okay. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Spencer, K2AEM, to talk a little bit more about the Solar Eclipse QSO Party.
Hello. I am Spencer Gunning, K2AEM. I was brought into ham radio just a year ago. I'm very new to all of this, but it's been a great experience so far, and the fact that I'm here right now is pretty amazing. So anyways, getting into the SEQP and more of the statistic analysis, Dr. Frissell mentioned that the SEQP was one of HamSCI's many experiments that were run during the eclipse, and you may have seen this logo right here on shirts and ceramic coffee mugs, maybe, and this was made by me in an attempt to publicize the SEQP as much as possible, and we use this Eclipse logo. And the actual event during 1400 and 2200 UT was on the day of the eclipse, obviously, and we asked ham radio operators to flood the airwaves with QSOs. So just like your favorite ARRL contest, the SEQP was also designed to function just like one of those contests. We're going to award a set number of points for one type of contact, but however, bonus points will be given out for operators who went above and beyond the call of duty and submitted extra information such as data from RBN nodes. So at the end of the SEQP, we opened up a log submission page which I designed for operators to submit their data. And the main focus of this was for operators to submit a log file, a Cabrillo log file, full of their contacts, QSOs, made by the operator or group of operators. And if you actually operated in the SEQP and you haven't submitted any of your data, the log submission page is still open until the end of this month at hamsci.org/submit-logs. So,
Spencer, what do you get if you submit your log here?
You get a certificate.
Yes, downloadable PDF certificate that Spencer also designed.
Yeah, you can immediately download that. We may or may not add some special certificates for those who got high points during the contest. So from those submitted logs, we generated plenty of statistics regarding the SEQP. And as of last week, there have been 571 logs submitted, 28,694 total QSOs, 5,201 unique call signs, 4,371 unique grid squares, and 864 non-US call signs. So that's just a lot of data, that's a lot of participation, and this is just the tip of the iceberg. We still have two more weeks of data collection before the website closes, and we're gonna use that to analyze future changes in the ionosphere and possibly future eclipses as well. So as you can see, there's some participation going on in the Solar Eclipse QSO Party. You have Dr. Frissell here, and over here, you have members of the NJIT branch of HamSCI working at Jenny Jump and operating during the SEQP. So, while that was only a brief statistical analysis of the SEQP, I'm going to pass the mic to Mr. Josh Vega, WB2JSV, to talk about a detailed analysis of the eclipse.
Thank you. I'm Joshua Vega. I am WB2JSV. I used to be KD2NKK, so that's why I said that. What I focused on was simulating the eclipse. In your proceedings, you'll find a paper that's titled Writing an Eclipse Simulation for Greater Good. That talks about how I wrote, how I took an eclipse simulation that we wrote and improved it and made it parallel to run on a high processing computing cluster. I'm not going to talk about what I did, but I'm going to talk about the results that came out of that and some other results that we got from the SEQP. There we go. So this is this first plot is from the RBN data that was that we talked about earlier. So the 600,000 spots we got. This is a plot showing the different bands across time, and you can see. Right about here is where there's a gray area and there's another gray area here. So this is where the SEQP starts, this is where it ends, and this like not gray area in the middle, that's actually where totality was over the US. So it starts over here at Oregon, ends over here at South Carolina. You can see that it's pretty obvious where the SEQP starts, people start talking, and then where it dies out, people stop talking. Then in the middle here, you can see there's a pretty big drop from this peak of 12,000 spots in a 15-minute bin. So that's each data point is 15 minutes worth of spots. Right here in the middle, you can see this big drop. There's a few reasons for this drop. Obviously, one that we believe is the eclipse itself, but you know, there's also a lot of people who may have stopped operating to look at the eclipse. It's a little bit of both. You can see very clearly that 20 meters drops significantly from this peak. 40 meters is pretty stable, relatively speaking. 80 meters and 160 meters, they kind of rise up towards the second half of the eclipse and then drop back down about a half hour later. That's some really interesting data that we collected. We haven't really worked that much with doing statistical analysis on the RBN data. It's a good picture. This is also just to point out that this is only the U.S. This is only U.S. transmitters and RBN receivers. So this doesn't count for international communication. Next we have this video. Let me see if I can play the video. There we go. All right. This is a video made by Anthea Koster of MIT Haystack. And so this is using GPS satellites to calculate total electron content for the US. And so let me play it again. So you can clearly see right here, you'll see this dark blue just crossing the US right here. So I mean, I guess I'm hoping you guys can guess what that is, and that is going to be the eclipse. Let me play it again. So it's really cool to be able to see it travel across.
Where do the ground stations come from? What are they?
I do not know. Yes. Nate, you wanna?
I can answer that.
Still not working?
I can answer that. So this is something called GPS total electron content. So these are just GPS ground stations that are scattered all across the United States. And they're used not actually to find position necessarily, but because they're permanently fixed, so they have known positions. So they actually provide feedback information back into the GPS system to correct for problems, say if the ionosphere is doing something funny. That's why these stations exist. So space scientists are able to use it because there's more than one GPS frequency that's transmitted to each of these receivers. And you can measure the delay between those two frequencies, and you can back out the number of electrons between the receiver on the ground and the satellites in space. So this is an integrated measure of the number of electrons between the satellite on the, or the satellite in space and the receiver on the ground. And then there are algorithms that let you make maps out of this using all of that data. So there's a lot of data reduction here. And as Josh said, this is this figure's courtesy of the MIT Haystack group.
Why are some of the dots moving?
So that's because the satellites are moving in the sky. So the position of the measurement changes as the satellites move. And each satellite will account for multiple dots, because many receivers can listen to one satellite and produce multiple measurements. And that's why you'll see some of these very sharp lines in the analysis. That's as the satellite moves together. Yes?
Can I interject a couple of other minor points associated with this measurement system? What you're seeing here in the total electron count, this is all fallout, actually, of geodetic survey measurements and what we used to call nuisance parameters that fall out of these. We didn't know we were going to get total electron count. We didn't know we were going to get the variability in this, and we didn't know we were going to see, precipitable water vapor. So there's an awful lot of science that has actually come out of just trying to measure positions with GPS.
And that's actually a good model for what we're doing, because a lot of the RBN data, the WhisperNet data, the PSK reporter data, isn't necessarily designed to measure what we're trying to measure it with. But we can see with the GPS systems, we were able to get something very useful about the ionosphere, and that's what we're trying to do here too, is we're taking this ham radio data and trying to get just a useful byproduct of this through correct processing. Back to Josh. Yeah?
I have a question on the last slide, if we're done with this one.
The previous one?
On the previous slide? The dip that you have there, you have the Cabrillo log files, right?
No, this is entirely Reverse Beacon Network data.
So do you have timestamps on any of those?
Yes, from the Reverse Beacon Network.
Okay, I was going to see if maybe you could detect if there is a decrease in actual transmissions from that, so that you could correct it for a lack of activity because of everybody going outside looking.
Yeah, exactly. That's going to be one of our next steps.
Okay.
For sure. Thank you. Thanks, Nate, for explaining that, by the way.
Thank you.
Much better than I could ever do. So these are some 2D ray traces that we generated. And so up here, we have a non-eclipsed one. So this is through a ionospheric model that has no attenuation because of the eclipse. So it doesn't change as the time stamp changes. There's no change in the ionosphere. It's relatively normal. So this is without an eclipse. And then down here, we have one with an eclipse. So you can see that from the background, you can see that there's a lot of orange here in the middle, whereas there's not so much orange on the bottom one. So that's the eclipse changing the electron content and the electron density in the ionosphere. And so because of this, you can see that rays that are bouncing back to Earth, that are being reflected back down to Earth, not all of them are being reflected now. A lot of them are going up into the space and just being lost. And you can also, another observation is you can see that in the non-eclipsed one, we get touchdowns around 100 kilometers from the transmitter, whereas in the eclipsed one, we don't start getting touchdowns until about 800, 850. So this is another observation that we've been able to make from the simulation. And there's a few reasons for this. The main reason is just basic trigonometry, where you have high for the non-eclipsed ones, the higher takeoff angles of the rays, they're able to be reflected back down, and you know, angle in equals angle out, so it just comes back down in a shorter ground distance. Whereas in the eclipsed one, those rays that are being shot off at a high angle elevation, they're not being reflected. They're being let to go out in space. So they're not hitting so close to the transmitter as you see in the base one. Another observation that you can see is right around here, you can see some ducting, so it's not being reflected back down. It's kind of like coasting for a bit before being reflected back down into the Earth. So that's really cool. And you can see some of that up here, but it's a little hard to see because of the ray traces. So in this ray trace simulation, we were transmitting from, we were ray tracing from AC4PA in Georgia to a RBN receiver WE9V in Wisconsin. So this is about 990 kilometers. So the receiver would be right around there. So in both cases, the receiver would theoretically pick up the transmission. So yeah, I just put this one up because it's pretty. So we're using a FARLAP ray tracing toolbox, which is a fairly well-known toolbox for doing ionospheric ray traces in academia. And John Huba from the U.S. Naval Research Laboratories was kind enough to give us his SAMI-3 ionospheric model. And so that's actually the model of the ionosphere that we're using for these ray traces, and the actual ray traces are being computed through FARLAP. So it's really nice. So next, let's talk about the actual SEQP, one that I ran just after the SEQP completed. So this is a map of the US showing all the stations, all the transmitters and receivers. So there's a really high level of uniformity in the transmitters. And that's because what we did is we took every four-character grid square in the US, got the lat long for the center of it, and used that as a transmitter. That way we can get a nice distribution across the entire country. So that's the blue dots. The red stars are actually receivers. Those are the RBN receivers that were found to be active during the SEQP. So we cross-referenced the RBN data from the SEQP with the RBN's list of receivers, got their grid square, got their lat long, and from there we were able to place them on a map. So what we did for the actual SEQP ray trace was we ray traced from every one of these blue dots to every one of those red stars. So it's very process intensive, very long. Each of the simulations from this took about 3 days, running 32 parallel processes. So it's a lot of work. I don't know why Florida's like that and why Lower Texas is like that. That's might have been an error in my of mine when I was selecting grid squares, but you can see we have pretty much the entire U.S. For the next few plots, these are going to be the data points that we're using to generate the data. So let's go into some plots. Come on, there you go. So this is using the non-eclipsed SAMI-3 ionospheric model. So what we did here was, like I said, we did every grid square of the US to every RBN receiver active during a time. And so this is the distance of a hop, or the median distance of a hop for each timestamp during the simulation. So what we consider a hop is one reflection from ground to ground. So if we go back to these ray traces, we would consider one hop to be doot. So like start here, land there. Or start here, land there. So that's what we're measuring in these plots. So you can see the average in this simulated, remember this is all simulation data, in this simulated skip distance or hop distance, which is that one ground-to-ground contact, we're looking anywhere between 1,000 to 2,000 for the upper bands, or for the lower bands, and 15 megahertz is for some reason way up here, and it doesn't appear until about 2030. So that's interesting, or 2015 or so. That's interesting. That might be an error in the simulation. We're not quite sure. We didn't have time to fix it because we did this like last week, right before we left. But yeah, so everything seems pretty normal. This gray area is what during the totality. So we're not seeing anything when no totality would be there. And then, you know, nighttime comes around here, so 20 meters starts to go up in distance, and then eventually it'll just stop. But now if we look at the same simulation, the same data set in the eclipse ionosphere, we get this. So we can see here that 20 meters during the eclipse skyrockets, more or less, in skip distance. So it reaches, just over 3,000 kilometers. 15 meters comes in later, about an hour later than it did in the previous plot. Don't know why. 40 meters rises a little bit. 160 and 80 meters, they're pretty normal. There's not a lot of change between the two of them. This is interesting. So this means our simulation is seeing something, But it's also interesting to see how it goes from all the way up here to all the way down there in a 15-minute difference of 15 minutes. So it's about a change of 1,000 kilometers, which is really weird. So we're going to have to do definitely more work on the simulation, change parameters, see what happens. I don't know, you know, science. So now this is the total distance from transmitter to receiver of the simulated data. So this is the same data set, same transmitters. Now we're not just looking from ground to ground, we're looking from transmitter to receiver. So again, this gray area is the totality, and distance of successful QSOs, it rises a bit and then it drops another, you know, 1,000 kilometers for some reason. And then it rises back up suddenly and it just goes on its merry way. We don't know why that's happening. This is very interesting. And we don't know what to do about it.
I have one thought.
Yeah.
So one possibility is that we saw that the hop distance gets longer, right? But then the whole total QSO distance. So if the hop distance gets longer, maybe it gets to a point where single hop, so this is the one with hop distance, right?
Yep.
Hop distance gets longer, and that's all good. But this next one is like total QSO distance, so accounting for multiple hops. Mm-hmm. So maybe at the beginning where, misses? Yep. So maybe what's happening is that the we're just gradually getting into the eclipse, into the preumbra over here, and the hop distance is getting slightly longer, and we're seeing mostly like single hop communications, but it gets to a point where, or maybe even double hop communications, but it gets to a point where things just break down and it can't support those long QSOs anymore. So because we know that even though the hop distance is getting longer, the ionosphere is also getting weaker, so more things are escaping out into space. So it's probably looking at those two parameters, both hop distance and number of QSOs that are able to complete, that's causing this rise in distance and then sudden drop. Mm-hmm. But more on that later. Yeah.
Very quick question. Do you believe that deionization occurs at the same rate as...
Do you believe that deionization occurs at the same rate as reionization when the eclipse passes, or is it possible that those rates could be different? Like there's a decay rate in...
I think the rates are slightly different.
Okay.
And I think the rates are also different depending on the layer of the ionosphere you look at. So the D region chemistry is different from the E or the F region chemistry.
That could have bearing on that first graph.
Yes.
Okay.
One more question.
Yes.
Do you take into account the path loss in your... extra lengths?
Not in this simulation.
So it couldn't be that the signals just get too weak and all of a sudden it's not possible to...
That's right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
So what we're doing is we're just simulating up to three hops.
Yeah. I think here,
regardless
of
signal loss.
I think as the eclipse goes on, you're going to see less signal loss per se because of absorption, but you're going to see more signals escape out into space because the ionosphere can't support refracting them back down.
One of the other things you may be looking at here, when you have a rigid grid environment like you're trying to model on, is you could very well be running past the extents of your grid. If you'd actually extended the grid well beyond just the critical U.S. region, you might have seen a different result.
Mm-hmm. That's true, too, yes.
So like a boundary condition.
Oh, it's absolutely a boundary condition and reflection.
And another theory I actually... cooked up in my hotel room earlier, is we notice that this drop is on the second half of totality. So if we go back to our map of all the receivers, a lot of the receivers are on the East Coast. So there, during second half of totality, you know, the eclipse is going to be around here. So these transmitters over here may have trouble getting to all these receivers in the Northeast Corridor. That's just something I haven't really looked into that. I just thought of that. Maybe it's a possibility. So this is all simulated data that I've been showing you so far. Let's look at some real data. So this is what the SEQP logs have shown us. So it's the same. It's similar to the last plot. So it's by band. And this is total QSO distance of the QSOs that were submitted in the SEQP logs that Spencer talked about being submitted. So you can see there's no form of regularity. Everything is just scattered around, except for a few. You can see that 20 meters is pretty constant during the eclipse, which is weird, because if we go back to our simulated data, we're seeing this. So like Nate said, and a few of you mentioned, we're not taking into account signal loss and a few other parameters. So there's definitely the possibility that that's a cause for such a distinct difference between simulated and real. So we don't know about that yet. But we also see down here that 40 meters is pretty undisturbed. 160 meters rises here in the second half of the eclipse. Yep. Yeah.
You chose to show us the median distance, but there's actually going to be a distribution because there's a whole bunch of contacts at a given time slot. And I'm wondering what those distributions look like and why you're showing us just the median from that distribution.
So the reason we're showing the median is because we've been using the median on all these previous plots. So because of the data set we're using, where it's every grid square to a selection, you know, all the receivers, if we were to do min, like a range of the minimum and maximum, you'd be getting, you know, zero to whatever. So median gives us a really good idea of what's happening. So just for uniformity and so that we have one more or less one-to-one comparisons, we just did median for these as well. But yeah, it's definitely possible that there's really nice long range and there's a really close range that we're just not taking into account.
I'm having trouble imagining what the distributions look like. I realize now I should have asked the same question when you were showing us the simulations, but
I just want to stress that these are first look.
Yeah.
So just to give you an idea, right after the eclipse, I got married. I went on my honeymoon. And then we came back and we're like, oh my gosh, we have to get all this data from everybody and put it together. And so these are the very first looks at this data. So we will be accounting for distributions. You know, we're planning on taking this all the way to publication. So we'll get there.
Perhaps the better, more helpful question I could ask is, could you help us understand what a median means in this data set?
So a median would be looking at the upper and the lower bound and finding where the middle is.
The 50th percentile. I know median means 50th percentile, but what does that mean to us about radio propagation in this data set?
It does mean something. You can think of the median as a type of average. So on...
What we're seeing is
that here from this plot you can see that the 21 megahertz clearly dropped, and that's a very nice visible signal. And we can also see that the 160 meter black that rose, and that corresponds with our basic understanding of what we think should happen, and that also corresponds with what we saw in the simulation, and that the higher frequencies have worse propagation during the eclipse because that MUF disappears, but the lower frequencies have better propagation because the D region disappears and you have less absorption.
You will visualize this differently.
Yes, we will. Yeah.
Well, actually, Nate, it's your turn again. Summary.
Okay.
That's pretty much all I got.
Thank you very much, Josh. So, with that, we do have a summary, and that is, what is the Ham Radio Sciences Investigation? It's an organization that, you know, allows university researchers to collaborate with the amateur radio community and vice versa. Two, we are working on developing a database to combine all of these different data sources, the RBN, Whisper, PSK Reporter, DX Cluster, put them all in one place and make them more usable for scientific research. And three, we ran many experiments relating to the total solar eclipse, and our preliminary results show that there is some effect, some major effect of the eclipse on propagation. And so further work is going to show, will help us to answer some of these scientific questions that we have about the ionosphere. So I'd like to give special thanks to many different people. I'm sure this list is not exhaustive, but many of these people are on here, and some of these people are sitting in this room. And I think the important thing to know is that this is a citizen science project. We have a lot of people who are contributing to this data set and to this work, and thank you to all of you. And we have a few references to Naval Research Laboratory, which provided us with the numerical model that we used for our simulation, the numerical model of the ionosphere, and this HF propagation toolbox, which you can get a hold of yourself by emailing Manny Cervera at this address. And another plug, I'd like to just thank K2MFF, the Ham Radio Club at NJIT, for connecting me with these students. And I just want to say that, you know, we have a nice, active, vibrant club. So you can see some of the people here. This is our primary club advisor here, Pete, and you can see the students who are at this conference here working on the radio with me. We participate in contests. Sometimes we let some of the students play with soldering irons. And over here, this is last year, we were helping out at the New York City Marathon, and we always help out at mile 24. So we'll be there again this year, providing public service communications at the New York City Marathon. And closing, I have an announcement to make. We will be hosting a HamSCI workshop at NJIT in Newark, February 23rd through 24th. So we're going to invite the professional community to come and give some presentations. We also invite presentations from the amateur community. A major theme of this workshop is going to be ionospheric eclipse effects. So most of the data that we've shown today is out there for you to download right now. And the rest of it that's not out there will be out there as soon as we finish collecting all of the SCQP logs. We do have plans on releasing that publicly once we get the scoring done and things like that. So we would like you to go try your best at doing that, and we will have details on the HamSCI website and publicized through the AWRL on how you can submit your papers and present and also talk with other professional scientists who will be there. That's one thing we're going to be doing. I anticipate another thing. There have been some ideas. I know Ward has been pushing this idea to have a space weather station similar to a personal weather station. You have a personal space weather station. We would like to define what that space weather station would be. So at this meeting, this is another topic we'll be talking about. We'll be looking for ideas about what would go into a space weather station and why, and how would you put that together? How would we integrate that? Like, I think those measurements we saw of WWV from Steve, that required having a receiver locked to a very good stable frequency reference. Can we put that in an integrated package for less than a few hundred dollars that can also provide IQ data recordings that can be also serve as an RBN and whisper and PSK monitor and also a lightning detector and all these other things? How many things can we put into like one little package? And that's one of the reasons we're presenting at Tapper, because you guys know how to integrate that sort of stuff. So this would be a great thing for you to come to NJIT.
And that's what the Sunday seminar is all about. You just summarized tomorrow's talk.
So come tomorrow, start thinking about that tomorrow, come back to NJIT in February and, you know, present your ideas and let's see where we can take this. So thank you very much.
Okay, let's go ahead and take a couple of questions here. I can't turn this mic on yet.
Okay. I think I can be loud enough.
No, you can't. You won't be
recorded. Let's get the other students out here too. So, and get them a microphone in case they want to have some input too.
You mentioned the unusual S curve in the WWV 10 megahertz Doppler data.
Yes.
Have you given it any thought? Because I had a private conversation a couple of days ago on that same subject, and we didn't have any thoughts to it.
I have not given it enough thought yet, so not too much.
Hi,
First of all, thank you for your research. My question is, with current analysis of ionospheric propagation, you have not reflection, but re-radiation of radio waves, and especially when you have ordinary and then extraordinary, and that causes, well, a lot of us that DX, you know, you might get a beam heading for a particular country here, but it might be 15, 20 degrees off if you have a directional antenna. Has your data indicated anything like that with the eclipse? Did it have any effect on...
We haven't seen it in our data yet. And one of the things that the amateur radio data does not do a good job of is accounting for both, say, X mode and O mode. So we might have to work with the professional community. Like, if you look at an ionosun, it's sensitive to both of those modes, whereas, like, your typical RBN receiver is not. So that's something we'll have to work with the professional community with. We can think about more. And also something to think about with this space weather station, you know, is that something that we would want it to be able to do is detect these two different polarizations.
Thank you.
All right. Big round of applause.
I want everybody to meet Jerry Krieger. Everybody give a big hand of round of applause for Jerry. He's our speaker for tomorrow. I want him to give a plug for his talk tomorrow.
Okay, so tomorrow I'm going to be talking about... Has anybody heard of APRS? Okay. Has anybody heard of the APRS weather protocol? Some of us have been playing with... the weather protocol and the data derived from that for a long, long time. And I'm going to introduce the concept of the Citizen Weather Observer Program, something that NOAA has been utilizing for almost 20 years, where we've got a lot of stations registered. And we'll talk about that in some length. We'll talk about some of the shortcomings of it, some of the benefits of it, and there are a lot of both. And maybe some of the futures for it. The other thing I want to talk about, and this was before I met Nathaniel today, was maybe it's time to add a lightning component to that, because in the commercial world, there are a handful of companies that are selling lightning data for a lot of money, and there's one major organization that has open source lightning data, but you can't get research grade information out of it, but you can get pretty maps. What if we were to create a lightning network that was based on software-defined radios and planned ahead of time and maybe integrated into the citizen weather infrastructure? So we'll talk about that, start some brainstorming, and after meeting Nathaniel, I'm going to be spending lots of time chatting with him because I think it's going to integrate with his space weather station nicely.
So you see what DCC is all about? It's bringing these great minds together. So this is really exciting. So I hope you can all join us tomorrow. I know we have over 52 people registered for tomorrow. So Nathaniel, is you and your group going to be here tomorrow? Good.